லாங் டைம். டிலேட்டா மேம், ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணுமா?
ஓகே சார்,
ஸ்டார்ட் பண்ணு.
சார் மேம்,
ஆ 1 மினிட் மேம், லைவ் ஸ்ட்ரீமிங். ஓகே
ஆ ஓகே மேம், ஓகே
க்ளோஸ் சார். Hey ma'am, let us start.
Yes ma'am.
Greetings and good afternoon to all. On behalf of PG and Research Department of Zoology, Satakathilampa College, it's my great pleasure to extend a very warm welcome to you all gathering here for the international webinar Microbiome: Understanding the Co-host-Pathogen Interactions. We believe that the greatest form of prayer is prayer to God for all events. Now the program is started with prayer. Now I invite M.K. Duhulabai to recite Holy Quran verses.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. Assalamu alaikum. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajeem. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين. அத்தியாயம் 1 சூரா அல் ஃபாத்திஹா தோற்றுவாய் வசனங்கள் 7. அளவற்ற அருளாளனும் நிகரற்ற அன்புடையவனுமாகிய எல்லாம் வல்ல ஏக இறைவன் அல்லாஹுவின் திருபெயரால் துவங்குகிறேன். அனைத்து புகழும் அகிலங்களின் இறைவனாகிய அல்லாஹுவிற்கே ஆகும். அவன் அளவற்ற அருளாளன், நிகரற்ற அன்புடையோன். அவனே நியாய தீர்ப்பு நாளின் அதிபதியும் ஆவான். இறைவா, உன்னையே நாங்கள் வணங்குகிறோம், உன்னிடமே நாங்கள் உதவியும் தேடுகிறோம். நீ எங்களை நேர் வழியில் நடத்துவாயாக. அது நீ எவர்களுக்கு அருள் புரிந்தாயோ அவ்வழி. அது உன் கோபத்துக்கு ஆளானோர் வழியும் அல்ல, நெறி தவறியோர் வழியும் அல்ல. சதகல்லாஹு அலியுல் அலீம். அஸ்ஸலாமு அலைக்கும் வரஹ்மத்துல்லாஹி தஆலா வபரகாத்துஹு.
Thank you நுபு. If your actions inspire others to dream more, learn more, and become more, you are a leader. I request our respected and beloved principal, Dr. A. Mohammed Sodiq, to deliver the presidential address. Welcome, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful, if you could count up the favors of God, never would we be able to number them. For God is all forgiving and most merciful, says the Holy Quran. Respected chief guest of this fine occasion, Dr. Yanendra Shanmugam, International Research Professor, Microbial Genomics Lab, Department of Biotechnology, Yangyang University, Yongsan, South Korea. Respected Dr. Delita Manojais, Head of the Department of Research and PG Zoology Department. Respected Dr. M.I. Zahir Hussain, respected Dr. Shifa Vanmadi, respected faculty members of the zoology department, and research scholars, guests from other institutions, friendly institutions, my dear students, really I feel very happy that the PG department of zoology research and PG department of zoology is conducting this international webinar on microbiome, understanding the host pathogen interactions. Really I feel very happy that the PG department of zoology is doing lot of laudable job inside the campus, and this is one among them, inviting great scholars internationally and enlighten the minds of our students and research scholars. In this direction, I really very happy to invite Dr. Yanendra sir for his laudable presence here, and in the end of the session we will know the facts about the microbiome, and we will understand the host pathogen interactions. I once again congratulate the faculty members of the research and PG department of zoology, and the research scholars and the students. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. What did you say?
Ma'am.
Yes, you welcome.
To welcome the gathering and the people in the dials, it is a very important to have a welcoming note. This respect, I would like to welcome Dr. M.I. Zahir Hussain sir, convener and research head, to present his welcome speech. Please, sir. Zahir sir.
Assalamu alaikum. Good evening to one and all gathered here to be a part of this knowledge sharing section. It gives me immense pleasure to deliver the welcome address. First of all, I welcome the principal of our college, our beloved Dr. M. Mohammed Sadiq sir, who has always been a source of inspiration for all the academic happening of our department. Welcome you, sir. Next, I am happy to welcome the vice principal of our college, Dr. SMA Sayed Mohammed Kaja sir, who gave a constant support in all our department activities. I welcome you, sir. It gives me a sense of pride and happiness to welcome the resource person of the day, Dr. T. Nanendra Sanmugam, Assistant Professor, Department of Biotechnology, UGM University, South Korea, who has been a very good friend of mine for the more than a decade, and always give his consent to this kind of knowledge sharing section. Today he is going to deliver a special talk on microbiome, understanding the host pathogen interaction. I welcome you, sir. I welcome Dr. M.I. Dalita Manoj Jose, Organic Secretary of this webinar and HOD of PG department. I welcome you, madam. I welcome Dr. Shifa Vanmadi, Assistant Professor, and Dr. Mohidin, guest lecturer, PG department of zoology. Welcome you all. It is my duty to welcome all the participants from our college and other college to this webinar. Welcome you all. This said, I in depth to welcome our technical team members who has been putting their constant effort in conducting such seminars. Once again, I welcome you all to this provoking session. Thank you one another.
Thank you, Zahir sir. Next in this event, I will like to welcome Dr. SMA Sayed Mohammed Khaja, our vice principal of our college, felicitate over the function. And he is the right person to deliver the felicitate address for the day. I welcome you, sir.
Thank you. Good afternoon and assalamu alaikum, Sonandal. The Almighty will show the peace and mercy to all of us. I begin in the name of Almighty, the most gracious and the most benevolent. Respected Principal, Dr. M. Mohammed Sadiq, respected resource person, Dr. Yanendra Sanmugam, Assistant Professor, International Research Professor, Microbial Genomics Lab, Department of Biotechnology, Yongkong University, Yongsan, South Korea. Respected Head and PG Department of Research, Department of Zoology and the convener of the webinar, Dr. M. Jagir Hussain, respected organizing secretary, Dr. M. Julaitra Manochai, assistant professor, PG and Research Department of Zoology, respected organizing assistant coordinators, Dr. J. Sifa Vanmadi, Dr. M. Mohideen of PG and Research Department of Zoology, Dr. Siti Jamila,
current
head of the Department of Zoology, and respected controller of examinations, Dr. Rasa Apulkar, respected deputy controller of examinations, respected IQ coordinator, respected dean of arts, dean of sciences, and respected dean of research and development, and faculty members, scholars, and participants and students. Really, I am immensely happy to participate in this international webinar on microbiome understanding the post-pathogen interaction, being organized by the Department of PG and Research, Department of Zoology, and to offer my felicitations on this admission. I congratulate the department for having selected this topic for discussion in this webinar. The topic of the webinar is highly useful to the everybody at the unprecedented time due to the outbreak of second wave of the COVID-19, a global pandemic. Regarding our resource person, Dr. G. Nanendra Sandhavan, he is an young and energetic personality and academician, working as international research professor in Yonkong University, Johnson, South Korea. He has an excellent research career with an RG score of 25.48. He is an expert in the areas of density functional theory, environmental microbiology, microbial ecology, docking, dyes, virtual screening, quorum sensing, quorum modeling, and quorum sensing, and biofilms, dog protein modeling, and rational deep design. So regarding this seminar, the host pathogen interaction is defined as how the microbes and viruses sustain themselves within the host organism on a molecular, cellular, organizational, or population level. The term is most commonly used to refer to disease-causing microorganisms, although they may not cause illness in all hosts. Because of this, the definition has been expanded to how known patterns survive within their host, whether they cause disease or not. In the past, medical microbiology has largely relied on simplifying assumptions of one-to-one relationship between a single pathogen and a single disease, or between a single gene or virus-related phenotype. Now, thanks to the technical and conceptual advances, we are moving towards a new paradigm. The new outlook proves the boundaries between the pathogen and common cell. On this view, the pathogen is more like guerrilla warfare or terrorism than a clash between standing armies. The success of pathogens like that of COVID-19, which threatened the world for the past 2 years. I take this opportunity to thank our respected principal, head and the faculty members of the PG and Research Department of Zoology and the distinguished resource person for having provided this platform to impart knowledge on this area. And I appreciate the organizers of the webinars, and I facilitate our fellow participants, students, and all participants. Thank you, one and all. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Now the time is to introduce our resource person. So I would like to invite Dr. M. I. Dilaita Manojai, HOD, PG Department of Zoology, to introduce our resource person, Dr. T. Nyanendra Shanmugam. Welcome, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you all. Glory to Almighty God. Good afternoon to everyone who has joined us today in the international level webinar hosted by PG and Research Department of Zoology, Sadakatala Appa College, Tirunelveli. First of all, I thank Almighty God for giving me a wonderful opportunity to organize this international level webinar. My heartfelt thanks to all my well-wishers, faculties from various other colleges, and my colleagues for their guidance and support. I deem it a privilege bestowed upon me to introduce our resource person, Dr. P. Nanendra Shanmugam, International Research Professor, Annam University, South Korea. He did his MSc in Bioinformatics, MPhil in Biotechnology, and PhD in Bioinformatics. He received Honors Diploma in Network Computing from NIIT Chittoor, certificates in drug designing software like Sirius-2, Insight-2, Catalyst from Accelerate from USA, and certificate in rational drug designing from GVK Bio Hyderabad. He is very proficient in using bioconductor or package and various bioinformatics tools, software database development by using Python, Java, and PHP. Sir is an expert in NGS data management and analysis of RNA sequence, chip sequence, whole genome assembly, and metagenomics. He started his career as a lecturer in the Department of Bioinformatics in 2004 at Vivekananda College of Arts and Science, Tiruchengur, worked as assistant professor and joint director for research, Department of Biotechnology, Selvam Arts and Science College, Namakkal, in the year 2012-13, and as training consultant in bioinformatics division, Origin Biosolutions, Salem. And he worked as a research associate at Center for Research and Development, Mahindra Engineering College, Namakkal, in the year 2016. He served as a postdoctoral research scientist at Microbial Genomic Laboratory, Department of Biotechnology, Annam University, South Korea, from 2016 to 2018. Now he has been working as an international research professor, Department of Biotechnology, Annam University, South Korea, from 2008 until date. He has published many papers, more than 25 in the international journals with the Science Citation Index till 2021. He has the skill to handle various bioinformatics software such as molecular docking tools, virtual screening tools, sequence analysis tools, and the list goes on. Such an eminent research professor is now with us today to enrich our knowledge on today's webinar topic, microbiome, understanding the host pathogens interactions. I'm very glad to invite Dr. T. Nanendra Shanmugam sir to take over the session. Sir, please, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, ma'am. So, good evening to all. It's a great pleasure to be here. And I thank the organizers for giving me an opportunity and providing me a platform, a nice platform, to share my research on microbiome. So again, I would like to specially thank Dr. Jagir Hussain, so who was a nice friend of me. So it's been so long that I have met him, and I had an opportunity to see him here right now. So with this, I would like to jump into my topic. Microbiome, understanding the host pathogen interactions. I'm just sharing my screen. So is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So today's topic of interest is like microbiome, understanding the host pathogen interactions. So as we all know that we have been surrounded by various creatures, and especially we call them as often microorganisms, which cannot be seen with our naked eye. So before jumping into that, let's see that what are the microorganisms, what are the organisms, and how many genes has been present in each kind of an organism, so that we'll have an idea that how big how complex the nature is, and how each and every cell has been interacting with each other. So let's take here like a simple bacterium and E. coli, so which is said to be having a false chromosome, and which is having around 5,000 genes, and counting the base pairs in that organism will be like 4.1 million base pairs. So in the same way, if you come for an higher organisms, like in human beings, we can see like we have 46 chromosomes, in which we have around 28 to 35,000 genes, and it accounts for 3.1 billion base pairs. So you cannot imagine that how much time it is going to take for us to count this 3.1 billion base pairs. So it's in fact that it says that it takes 94 years to count the DNA in one cell. So you can imagine that how much of DNA which base pairs we are having, and we need to find out what are the interactions of each and every base pair. So that's a different story. So where we are going to deal with a genome of a human and genetics of a human. So here, before going into that, just this is the figures which we should remember always, like as we are and human beings, we should know what is a number, what is a number which is pertain to us. So like we have 46 chromosomes in each cell, and we have 28,000 to 35,000 genes. And the longest gene is like 2.4 million base pairs, and it's in dystrophin. And we have 3.1 billion base pairs. And altogether, there are 75 to 100 trillion cells in a human body. So this is about the numbers about a human body and what are the genes which has been present in that. So now, if you take this, it takes almost 3.1 million years to count this 100 trillion cells. So now you can imagine that how much huge complex data we are having, and how could one can solve this? How could one can see this? What is the function of each and every gene? So that's a place where we are going to make use of computers, and that's called as a separate field called as of an bioinformatics, or you can call it as of a computational biology, whatever we want. So now coming for this, before going for this microbiome research, so let's talk about what is a microbiology and what we were thinking about and microbiology. So when we call it as of a clinical microbiology, we usually consider that we have an microorganisms which are and casual agents of some diseases. And we all know that if you take a simple antibiotics, we are going to get rid of this microorganism. So this is what we know. And we have been thinking that these microorganisms can be seen by using an microscopes, and based upon their growth and based upon their morphology, we are going to say that what kind of a microorganism. So this is what we know, how we are going to deal with an each and every microorganism. And after this invention of these computers and sequencing technologies, so we are going to call it as often computational microbiology. So this computational microbiology, so here we are going to say that, so if you want to culture some microorganisms, or if you want to identify a few certain kinds of microorganisms, we need to culture it. So this culturing technique says that we cannot culture almost 99% of the bacteria. So the reason behind this is we need to understand what kind of a growth media that specific bacteria needs, and what are the nutrients it needs, and how this bacteria can compete with other bacteria in that. So we call it as of a general media, and we call it as of a selective media, so and so. So each and every kind of a bacteria needs its own kind of nutrients to grow. So in that case, if you're going to culture and bacteria from specific environment, it's like we are going to get failed to in order to culture those bacteria. So we can say that 99% of the bacteria are unculturable. So hence we cannot know what kind of and bacteria has been present in a specific environment. So this is the place where we are going to make use of most advanced sequencing technologies by using in primers. We are going to extract the DNA, and we are going to amplify that, and then we are going to sequence it, and we are going to find what kind of a microorganism has been present in the so-and-so environment. So in this case, this is the place where we are going to come across a specific gene called as of an rRNA genes in case of bacteria, whereas in case of fungi, we call it as of an ITS sequences. So by using this marker genes, so these are called as of an marker genes, we are going to make use of this marker genes, and we are going to identify what kind of an bacteria has been present in it. So this is a most advanced technique where one can identify what are the microorganisms present in a specific environment. So we can call it as of a computational microbiology, or we can call it as of a genomics. So if you say this microbiology before our microbiome, so as I said that we cannot culture more than 1% of the bacteria. So still it says that whatever the culture you are going to isolate, we are going to say that we got only less than 1% of the bacterial isolates. So we are going to make use of our technology. So now coming for the terms, what kind of terms which we are going to come across here is like a microbiota. So this microbiota deals like an identifying what are the total microbial communities colonizing a particular habitat. So which has been seen in a specific environment is called as of a microbiota. And the same way we are going to use an another term called as of a microbiome. So which deals with the genomes of the specific microorganisms. So the collective genome of all the microbial cells living in a particular habitat, and in special focus is on human microbiome. So we are going to study the composition of microorganisms, and we are going to say that how far this organisms, whether this is an beneficial to a human or it's a pathogen microbe. So with this goal, the Human Genome Project has started, and they have given the numbers like, so the human body is made up of almost like 3.3 million microorganisms. So we have been surrounded with 3.3 millions of microorganism genes. So as we all know that when we are saying that human beings at the level of genetics, we are going to say that two individuals can share a 99.9% of genes. So that 0.1% of variation makes a different individual. So this is what we know from our genetics, like two individuals going to share a 99.9% of genes. Whereas if you come for a microbiome, so two individuals are 80 to 90% dissimilar. So it means my microbial composition and compared to other individual microbial composition, there will be an 80 to 90% variation. So these microorganisms are the one which is making our metabolic system perfect or an imperfect. So we can call it as of a healthy individual or a diseased individual. So all this depends upon the microbial flora which we have been surrounded with. So if you are going to say that you fall ill very quickly, it means that you are having an improper microbial flora. So if you have been very healthy, it means that your microbial flora is very good. So this is the place where we come across the other genome of our human body. So that's called as of a gut microbiome. So gut microbiome is legally called as of another genome of a human body. So if you're going to safeguard your gut microbiome, no doubt you're going to stay healthy. So it's very important to protect our gut microbiome, and it's very important that we should not destroy our gut microbiome by using an antibiotics and all. So this area of research is going with an high speed, like identify what are the bacterial organisms which has been colonizing our body and how these microorganisms has been helping our body, or what are the microorganisms which has been acting as of pathogens to destroy the system. So this is a prestigious project of an NIH. So they made started a project called as of a human microbiome. So the ultimate goal of this is to identify what are the total microbes has been seen in the body and surrounded by the body, and what is the genome and how this genomes is helping. So genomes are nothing but the number of genes which has been present in each and every microorganism. So how this how the genomes of an each and every bacteria is helping a human body, or they're opposing a human body's function. So this is the ultimate goal of a human microbiome. And this is a prestigious project of NIH, National Institute of Health. So in future, we may get as an ID card, our human microbiome can be given as of an ID card. So it means that each and every individual microbiome is specific, is unique to each other. So we have been surrounded with microorganisms wherever we go, and we are starting our life with a microorganism. So there is a theory like when a child has been born, so based upon the mode of birth, like an cesarean birth or like an normal delivery, so the microbial flora differs from these two individuals. And there is a study like which says that the kids who have been born through a C-section are more prone to asthma. So it means that there is something which is happening, it's based upon and microorganisms. So like this, if you look into the gut microbiota, gut bacteria, so they have role in each and every function. And so each and every microorganism is associated with each and every function. So like nervous system modifications, breakdown of food compounds, pathogen resistance, and injury against an epithelial cells, bone mass density, promotion of fat storage and angiogenesis, biosynthesis of vitamins, immune system stimulation, and metabolism of therapeutics. So these are the main functions which has been performed by our bacteria. So this is an picture which can say you that how the microorganisms been associated with the and human beings. So we can see here that at the stage of birth of a kid, we can see here only one class of bacteria, one family of bacteria has been associated with that. So we can, it's an like an enterobacteriaceae. So at the time of birth, we can see that the human body has been associated with only one family of bacteria. And as soon as the kid grows, we can see here there is large diversity. The diversity of bacteria has been increasing. So we can see based upon the functions, based upon the work which we are going to do. So we need a new kind of bacteria which can help us to perform those tasks. So you can see here when the birth, during the birth, the child has been associated with only an enterobacteriaceae. At the after a month, we can see here that new bacteria has been coming into that, and where we can see an bifidobacteriaceae population is more high, and lactobacillaceae can be seen here. And at the age of 6 months, the baby starts crawling. So we can see here that he will be crawling here and there. So there will be and the increased diversity of microbes can be seen. And at the stage of 12 months, like started to have and there will be a change in the food habits and playing more. So we can see here, as soon as the child has been growing on, the diversity of microbes has been increasing. So it means that almost all the functions which has been performed by our body is purely dependent on an microbial flora which we are having. So this is another picture where it says that when a child is unborn, we can see that there is no microbial flora. So we can say that the baby is sterile. So no microorganisms has been seen in the baby when he is in the womb of a mother. So once the baby has been born, we can see here there is a different composition of microbes are based on and breastfeeding or formula feed or an solid food. We can see here, this is a clear picture which says that what kind of a bacterial population has been seen here. So in case of a baby who is dependent on an breastfeed, we can see here actinobacteria is more when compared to you can consider and firmicutes. So we can see the firmicutes level is very less in case of a breastfeed, whereas in case of a formula feed baby, we can see here the level of firmicutes is very high. So we all know that based upon which will be showing a significant impact on immunity of a baby. And the next thing is of a solid food. So when solid food has been introduced, we can see here that there is a complete loss of an actinobacteria, and a new kind of bacteria has been coming into the play, like an bacteroids. And then we can see an other kinds of bacteria has been coming into the role. So it clearly says that there is a variation in the bacterial community or in the microbial flora, which has been essential or which has been helping us and based upon the food habits. And the second thing is we can see here in case of a toddler. So this is a comparison which gives you an idea that how the microbial flora is changing based on an antibiotic treatments or an malnutrition. So which can say that how the healthy individual looks like. So in a healthy individual, we can see here that other bacteria and firmicutes level is more, as well as and bacteroids is more. Whereas in case of a malnutrition, we can see here the proteobacterial community is taking an upper hand. Whereas in case of an antibiotic treatment, we can see here there is a loss of some other bacteria. And whereas in case of an healthy individuals, adults, we can compare like healthy and obese people or whatever the disease you want to compare, we can make a study like, So what is the microbial composition in a healthy individual and what's the microbial composition of an obese individual? Whereas when we come for an elderly people, we are going to see that what is the microbial flora which has been helping an individual. So it says that at every stage of our life, we are having and travel, we are traveling with this microorganisms and we are taking advantage of this microorganisms. We are making use of this microorganisms for our survival. In the same way, this microorganism tries to take an upper hand by using nutrients which has been provided in our body, and sometimes they turn out into pathogens, so which leads to and different kinds of disease. So this is an study or an picture which shows you that based upon and food habit, how the microbial community, how the microorganisms has been changing in the gut. So we can see here that when an individual changes his food habits, we can see the decreased diversity in the intestinal microbiome or increased cancer incidence. So it's not only in cancer. So because we are dealing with here like in gut microbiome, so this cancer relates to an colon cancer. So we can see here high microbial diversity gives to an enriched metabolic functions. So if you are having a more kind of an bacterial diversity, whatever the food we are going to take, the metabolism will occur in a proper way so that the food which we are going to take will be utilized and there will not be remnants of in food, or they are not going to produce any kind of toxins. So whereas the diversity of the bacteria starts to decrease, we can see that specific kind of foods cannot be digested, and which after a due course of time which can release and some kind of endotoxins or exotoxins, so which will directly affect our intestinal linings, so which leads to colon cancers. So this is another beautiful picture which says that how the Western diet and then non-Western diets, Asian diet, whatever we want to call it, it's of a non-Western, so as having a significant impact on our microbial community. So here we can see here, in case of a non-Western diet, in the gut microbiota, we can see here there is increase in bifidobacteria, bacteroides, Prevotella, and decreased in firmicutes. Whereas in case of in Western diets like burgers or fries or ice creams, we can see here there is a decrease in this bifidobacteria, bacteroides, and Prevotella, whereas the increase in firmicutes can be seen. So which says that these firmicutes are the ones which is acting as of pathogens. So what happens if there is an increased bifidobacteria, bacteroides, or Prevotella? We can see here there is more side chain fatty acid synthesis can be done. So which leads to butyrate or acetate or propionate increases will be there. So which helps in improving our mood. Whereas if the side chain fatty acids are not being, there is a decrease in this butyrate or acetate or propionate, we can see here there is an anxiety and which can induce our depression. So here we can see here, if you are taking a non-Western diets like various grains, legumes, anything, so we need a large diversity of bacteria. So if you start eating one similar kind of food every day, so we will make use of only one kind of bacterial family. So where we can see a decreased diversity in our intestine, so which leads to many complications. So apart from this, these are the various factors which is going to directly affect our gut microbiome. So like genetics and exercise and stress level, antibiotics or an age, gastric mobility or antimicrobial peptides or gastric secretions or diet and mode of delivery and geographical location. So these are all different factors which is going to have its influence on our gut microbiome. So one should know that how we are going to protect our gut microbiome by maintaining our health status and coming out of stress, or not using a lot of antibiotics, and trying to avoid the food which is going to increase your gastric secretions, and the kind of food which can increase the microbial diversity. And this is not in our hand, like mode of delivery. So it all depends upon our how we are going to maintain our health after a delivery. and geographical locations. So these are all the different environmental, these are the factors which is going to affect our human microbiome, especially and gut microbiome. So now let's come into the research, like how one can perform these studies. So how one can identify that what kind of a microbial community has been present, how we are going to interpret the data. So that's the story which we have seen, is like what we want to know and how we are going to, what study we are going to do. So now we are coming for a research area. So how we are going to perform this study. So we know that what we need to look into that. So now we are going to see that. So how we are going to perform this research by using and samples, which will be taken from different kind of environmental factors. So this, the whatever the things which I'm going to tell now is not strictly adhering to an human microbiome. This can be done on a plant microbiome or any whatever the organism which you have been interested, you can perform this research. So this is an PCO plot which says that how the microbial community, or what is the diversity of microbes which has been seen in different parts of our body. And this is an image which shows that what is the composition of an each and every phyla at each and every position, each and every location the samples has been collected. So here we can see here, this picture clearly says that the microbial community in gastrointestinal tract is very different from our oral community. So we know that whatever the food we are going to take is going to through our oral community, and here some certain process will be carried out by a certain group of bacteria. And then when the food enters into a gastrointestinal tract, there we have a specific group of bacteria which is going to perform the next task. And whereas when you come for an urogenital system, there is a different class of bacteria. Whereas if you look into the skin and nasal microbial flora, so there is not much distinction. So they have been clustered together. It means that we can see almost same kind of a bacterial community from our nasal as well as our skin. So these are different kind of a picture. So now here we can see here that, so how one can perform this study is like we can have an healthy individual and a diseased individual, and we are going to determine what kind of a good bacteria or what kind of a bad bacteria. So obviously we are going to say that if a person is an diseased, so he is having some kind of an infection, that infection might be some fungi or some bacteria. So microbiota establishment is very essential in order to protect our health. So if you have a good bacteria like a bifidobacterium species or E. coli or Fecalibacterium or Lactobacillus, an individual will be very healthy. If there is a loss of this bacteria, or there is an increase of some of this bacteria like Clostridium difficile or Campylobacter or Enterococcus faecalis or Methanobrevibacter, there will be an erosion of an lining, intestinal lining, which will subsequently lead to n different kinds of parameters. So like once the lining of our system, a lining of our intestine has been gone, we can see here that there is a series of reactions which is going to affect our system. So there will be a DNA damage by and mutations, and which is going to ultimately lead to an colon cancer. So here we can see here that once the bacteria tries to erode the intestinal lining, we can see here that macrophages, so which is going to ultimately affect the cytokines, and which is going to have an epithelial cell proliferation. So cell starts to grow. There will be no apoptosis. They are going to directly affect on our primary bile acids, so which is going to convert that into a secondary bile acids, which is going to have an effect, which is going to have an DNA damage effect, or they can be used in conversion of peptides or amino acids. So where they are going to produce and some kind of genotoxins, which can lead to chronic inflammations, or we can call it as colon cancer. So it's very important that we should maintain a proper gut microbiome. So this is the two terms which we are going to use, like symbiosis and dysbiosis. Symbiosis is like where a group of bacteria lives very happy and it is going to help an individual. Whereas dysbiosis, so there is some destruction in a community, so that one specific group of bacteria will be lost, or one specific new bacteria will be entering into the community, and which leads to different kinds of symptoms. So if you look here, like how the microbiome has been affecting and cancer establishment, we can see here in case of symbiosis, when there is a good understanding between each and every bacteria or a proper healthy bacterial status has been maintained, we can see here it gives you a tumor suppressive effect. So it means it is going to safeguard our body. So by providing an anti-inflammations or barrier functions or antioxidants, so which helps in vitamins and fatty acids, side chain fatty acids, mucin productions, and then cytokines. Whereas if dysbiosis occurs, it means there is a destruction in the bacterial community. It is going to lead us an oncogenic effects. So which will be any kind of an inflammations or gut permeability, barrier failures, DNA damage. So bile acid, exotoxins. So these are the significant impacts if an microbial community is being destructed. So which can lead to an specific cancers. So now we are going to see that how we are going to perform this research. So now once we are going to collect an microbial community, say for an example, I have two individuals, one is of a healthy and one is of a cancer patient. So now I need to find out what are the healthy microbes which has been seen in a healthy individual and what are the microbes which has been, what microbes has been lost in case of a cancer patient. So there we are going to establish a study called as of a microbiome. So where we are going to collect what is a bacterial or archaeal community or a fungal community in that specific individual. So there we are going to make use of a 16S rRNA sequencing and 18S rRNA sequencing. So these are the two different sequences which will be used as of a markers for the identification of bacteria as well as fungi. So this is an phylogenetic tree which says that we have been having, we are having and three different kinds of domains like bacteria, archaea, and eukaryota. So eukaryota, so it mainly deals with an fungi which we are going to call it as of an fungal pathogens. And when you come for an bacteria, we have we are going to make use of an 16S rRNA. In case of an archaea, we are going to make use of an 18S rRNA. So now, what is the ultimate goal of this microbiome study? Is like we are going to see that who is present in that community, whether the bacterial community is more or fungal community is more, or in case of bacterial community, which bacterial phylum is more, or whose phylum is less, and what they are doing there. So what function has been associated with each and every bacteria and how they are doing. So what kind of genes has been present in this bacteria. So these are the three things which we are going to deal with our microbiome study. So here, so first step is like we are going to collect the samples and we are going to extract the 16S rRNA sequencing. So which gives you almost all kind of bacteria which has been present in the specific sample. So this can be either 16S rRNA or 18S rRNA. And then we are going to study and population analysis, like we are going to classify that what kind of bacteria has been present, to which phylum they are present, and to which classes they are present. So now here we can see here and population analysis. So here we are going to deal with two kinds of topics like alpha diversity, beta diversity, and which says you that over or under representation of specific bacterial community. So this is the picture of our 16S rRNA gene where we come across a 9 hypervariable regions. So our 16S rRNA has been made up of 16 hypervariable regions. So if you take a full length of our 16S rRNA, it will be around 1,500 base pairs. Whereas if you take in each and every individual hypervariable regions, we will be having like 200 or 400 base pairs like that. So we know that in prokaryotes, we have a 70S ribosome and eukaryotes are made up of 80S ribosome. And again, the 70S has been made up of 30S and 40S, in which the 30S is having our 16S rRNA genes. So we are going to make use of the 16S rRNA gene and we are going to amplify the specific region of our 16S rRNA gene. And then we are going to assign what kind of bacteria has been present in this particular sample, and which is very easy to do. So if you take an 16S rRNA gene, so we'll be having a 9 variable regions. So where we are going to target only in specific regions like V1 to V3 or V3 to V4 or V3 to V5. And if you're going to have an archaeal population, we need to target like V3 to V6 regions. Whereas if you're going for an fungal community, we are going to target an ITS1 and ITS2 region. So if you're going for full length of your DNA, it is going to cost you more, like we are going to do an Sanger sequencing for each and every individual strain. Whereas if you're going for this V3 or V4 regions, these are called as an amplicons and small short stretch of your DNA. So these are called as an amplicons. And this technique is called as an amplicon sequencing method. So we are going to isolate an amplicons, and we are going to study the variance, what kind of a variance has been seen in this particular environment, and we are going to assign what kind of a bacteria is that. So a short stretch of DNA is enough for us to profile what kind of a bacteria has been present in this specific samples. So we are going to make use of this V3 or V4 regions. And these are the techniques, these are the machines, sequencing machines, which has been available for us to do this task. So if you're going to select an V1 to V3 regions, we are going to use the base pair length will be like 510 base pairs. We are going to use a machine called as often Roche 454. Whereas if you go for V3, V4 region, we are going to use an Illumina MiSeq, which comes around like 428 base pairs, and V3 to V5 region, like 548 base pairs, and again, Roche 454, and V4 region alone, HiSeq, and V6 to V9, we are going to use an Roche 454. So these are the different kinds of sequencing machines, which gives you millions of reads, which says that how many, what are the bacteria which has been present in our samples. And if you want to go for an V1 to V9 region, then we are going to use an PacBio systems. So these are the various kinds of and sequencing technologies, which we are going to make use of that in order to study an community, bacterial community or microbial community, which has been present in a specific sample. So it can, the sample can be either in plant soil or plant endophytes we can study, or in a human system like gut microbiome you can study, or oral microbiome you can study. So whatever the the research has been interested for you, we can do this studies. So these are the usually used primer certs for each and every amplicons. So like if you say for V3 to V4, we are going to use eight forward primer and 518 reverse primer. So this is a forward and 518 reverse primers. So by using these primers, we are going to amplify our samples, and then we are going to sequence it. So once we get n sequences, mostly we are going to end with n genus, so not for n species level. So here we are going to use only a 97% similarity, so which is going to tell us what kind of a genus is being present in that. And at a genus level, we can say that what kind of a functions can be associated for this specific genus of bacteria, say like an Pseudomonas or Klebsiella. So these are the genus level identification. So at a genus level identification, we can easily make an predictions like what kind of a functions has been associated for this specific bacteria. And if we are still interested in that, then we can know that what kind of a media can be used for growing this kind of a specific genus, and then we can alter the media to grow a specific species. So that's a next level of research, so which gives you, which makes you to make like a synthetic community, or we can specially design what kind of a bacteria we need once we know the microbiome community or microbial population which has been colonizing in specific environment. So now here we are going to deal with two other topics, like alpha diversity and beta diversity. Like once we get the sample, we need to analyze that whether the bacterial community has been present in an equal samples or not. So we are going to compare two individuals. Say for an example, here I have four samples which are taken from as often replicates from healthy and then a disease or treatment one or treatment two, whatever the thing which we are going to deal with. So let's take that in sample one. We can see here there are a different bacterial community. And in the second case also, we are having a different bacterial community, third sample and fourth sample. So here we are going to deal with two kinds of measures, like species richness and species diversity. So species richness says that how many microbes are present here, and species diversity says that how are the microbes balanced to each other. So it means that richness is here is 5 and richness here is 2. So it means that we have five different kinds of bacteria: red, green, yellow, purple, and blue. In case of sample two, we have only two kinds of bacterial population, like green and purple. So the richness of this sample is very low, and the richness of this sample is very high. And next criteria, like, so same case here, richness 4 and 5. And next case is like evenness. So whether this bacteria has been evenly distributed. So here you can see here, 2 red, green is 4, and 1, 1, 1 here, whereas here only 1 green is seen and more number of purple is seen. So it's not evenly distributed. So the evenness is very low in this sample. When you come for sample 4, we can see here high evenness. So 2 greens, 2 yellow, 2 blue, 2 purple, and 4 greens. So the evenness of sample is very high. So this is very important to when we are analyzing the samples. So it says that whether the sample is having more diversity or less diversity. So in this case, we can say that the sample 2 is having less diversity and sample 4 is having higher diversity. So it means the evenness and richness is very high in this sample. So once we analyze this, now we are going to see that how the treatment A is differing from treatment B and how the communities has been changing from treatment A to treatment B. So how we are going to study this is we are going to make an frequency table, or we call it as of an OTU table. So here we are going to list out what are all the bacteria. Say for example, here red is one kind of bacteria, green is one kind of bacteria, and blue, as the list goes on. And we are going to count that how many bacteria has been present in sample 1, sample 2, sample 3, and sample 4. So we can see here in sample 1, we have the red bacteria is 2. In sample 2, it's 0. In sample 3, it's 1. And sample 4, it's 2. So like this, we are going to make a chart. And then we are going to calculate what is the distance between the two samples. So it means that which two samples are closely related with each other. So we can see here sample 1 and sample 4 are closely associated with each other, and next is sample 2, and next is sample 4, sample 2. So which says that sample 2 is not at all matching with this three samples, this other three samples. It means the diversity in this bacteria is very far away from S1, S3, and S4. So how this has been calculated? So how we are going to make this dendrogram? So we can see here that this is a frequency table, and we are going to follow a formula like D sample 1 to sample 2 is equal to square root of x1 minus x2 whole square plus y1 minus y2 whole square plus z1 minus z2 whole square. So as it goes on, so we are going to calculate that what is the distance between sample 1 and sample 2. So here we can see here sample 1 and sample 2, 2 minus 0 whole square, 4 minus 1 whole square, 1 minus 0 whole square, 1 minus 0 whole square, 1 minus 9 whole square, as it is. So and taking a square root of that, so the value is like 8.8. When you compare the distance between sample 1 and sample 3, it's 3.87. When you compare sample 1 and sample 4, the distance is like 2.86. So it means that sample 1 and sample 4 are closely related with each other. Sample 1 and sample 3 are next closely related, and sample 1 and sample 2 are far away. So we can see here, sample 1 and sample 2 are far away. Sample 1 and sample 4 are closely associated. Sample 1 and sample 3 are next closely associated. So this is how the PCO plot has been made. So this is the things which we are going to do, and we are going to see that how the bacterial community has been associated with each other, whether they have been closely associated or distantly associated, so that it gives us an idea whether the healthy individual or a diseased individual is having the same kind of a bacterial community, or there is some changes in the bacterial community. And if changes has been there, what kind of a bacterial changes has been seen, and how we are going to restore those bacterial community. So this is what we are going to do in our microbiome research. So this is of a basic outline of the study. So how we are going to perform this? So once we collect a sample, we are going to extract the DNA, and then we are going to perform an amplification by using our 16S rRNA or 18S rRNA sequencing. So once we get in sequences, so we are going to sort it out like which sequence is from which bacteria, and then we are going to make a phylogenetic tree and then community composition. So this community composition can be done at any level of our taxonomy, like kingdom or phylum or class, order, family, or genus. So once we come for a genus level, once we know that, so Say for example, here I have a large number of Prevotella, or I have a large number of Bifidobacteriaceae. So then we are going to determine what is the functional role of each and every genera which we have identified. So this genera will tell us that whether this specific individual has lost some kind of a function or has attained a new kind of a function. So this is what we are going to do. And here, for performing these kind of studies, we are going to use an bioinformatics. So I want to make a special note here, like, so whenever we want to perform this kind of task, we are going to use a tool called as of Chime 2. And we need to have a little programming skills like R, and we need to be familiar with a Linux operating system. So these are the tools which are very essential to perform this kind of task, and which is of a command mode. So this Chime 2 will perform all this kind of an analysis which we are going to do. So when we are performing this kind of analysis, we are going to have a difficult time, like we need to write a long commands to perform this task. So we found, and it's while doing this kind of research, we find that it's very tough to give a long command, and if something wrong goes, again we need to retype all these commands. So I made an easy interface where every people can use this just by using like our ordinary Windows computers. So by selecting each and every file and just by clicking next, instead of writing a long command. And this paper has been recently published in BNC Bioinformatics under the name Easy Microbiome Analysis Platform. So now this is not that much tough to use. Like even if you don't know the programming skills, or even if you don't have a much exposure on Linux, one can perform this microbiome study by using our software, Easy Microbiome. So this is the outline of our software. So it is going to make use of our Chime programming skills, and it is going to extract, and it is going to identify what are the microbial communities, and it is going to give you the composition analysis, like what is the alpha diversity, what kind of a bacteria has been present. So it is going to give you a taxonomic classification at each and every level. And it is going to tell you that how many number of OTUs has been present, what are the features, at what level, phylum, class, order, family, genus levels. It is going to tell you what kind of bacteria has been present at each and every level. And it is going to tell you what kind of functions has been associated with each and every gene. So like Quikrus, Picrus, and Taxophon is for an bacterial function analysis. Fungals is for fungal community, fungal functional analysis. And then it is going to tell you that what are the different kinds of bacteria seen in healthy individual or in diseased individual. So we can easily identify that which bacterial group is seen in healthy individual and which bacterial group is seen in a diseased individual. So one can perform the analysis very easily by using this software. So now coming for this, how the understanding of microbiome can help us to deal with different kinds of diseases like cirrhosis or obesity or type 2 diabetes or rheumatoid arthritis. So, and here the special focus is on atherosclerosis cardiovascular disease. So this is published in Nature Reviews Cardiology. So there they made a study like what is the microbiome of an healthy controls and what is the microbiome of patients with an atherosclerosis vascular disease. So they came for and they identified a microbial community which has been associated with an ASCVD and an healthy individual. And they found out that what are the functions which has been enriched by using an Keg orthologs and what are the functions which has been depleted in this specific diseased patients. So like that, they made a specific microbiome for each and every disease, and they identified that how far the microbiome has been differing from ASCVD and cirrhosis, as well as obesity and ASCVD, type 2 diabetes and rheumatoid arthritis. So what is the distinct difference in the microbial community seen with the different kinds of disease? So this gives us a clear understanding that how one can recover from this disease by providing or by reestablishing the healthy individual microbiome in order to fight against this disease. And there are many success stories which by reestablishing an healthy microbiome, the disease can be suppressed. So this is the mechanism how one can perform, how one can reestablish an healthy microbiome. Say here, like a healthy microbiome, this is a healthy microbiome, and due to some pathogen infection, there is a dysbiosis. That means one specific group of bacteria has been entering into a healthy microbiome, and it is causing some problem here, and it which can lead to a disease state. So here we can see here loss of diversity and function has been lost, and by identifying, by performing a microbiome research, we can identify that what kind of a bacterial has been lost, and we can include those microbes as of a drug, or we call it as of a probiotics or pre-probiotics or postbiotics, or one more term we are going to use is like a fecal microbial transplanter. So through this different kinds of mechanisms, we are going to establish a healthy microbiome in order to revert back into a healthy state of a diseased person. So in future, this will be the future of our human microbiome. In future, we are going to depend upon a microbiome analysis of each and every individual, so which is going in rocket speed in Western countries. So now here we are going to see another a different aspect of establishing a microbial healthy microbiome, and it's called as of a fecal microbial transplanter. So we are thinking that this is a new term, but it's like an old wine in a new bottle. So this fecal microbial transplanter has been seen in fourth century in China by Hong, so who has made a human fecal suspension by who has given a human fecal suspension by mouth for a patient who had poisoning or severe diarrhea, and they have, and he was the one who has found this method in fourth century, and they made a miracle that a patient came back from brim of the dead. So it means in fourth century itself, they identified this fecal microbial transplanter technique. They used a human fecal suspensions, and the patient from within severe diarrhea has reverted back into a healthy state. And again, the same thing has happened in 16th century, like Li Shanxin has made this fecal transplant microbial in order to save from severe diarrhea, fever, pain, vomiting, and constipation. So this is not a new thing, but nowadays this is going to, in future, this will be a treatment therapy for many diseases which we are going to come across. So this is an outline of how microbiome study can help us to understand how the pathogens has been affecting, or how the microbes has been helping an individual, and how one can reestablish a healthy microbiome in order to have a proper health. So we are going to take a human microbiome, our gut microbiome, or we can call it as often fecal microbiome from a healthy individual, and we are going to sequence it, and then we are going to do an all sort of analysis, and then we are going to make a chart like what genes has been downregulated or what genes has been upregulated. So these genes in terms of microbiome. So what kind of an bacterial community has been lost, or what kind of a bacterial community has been increased? So we can make a comparison between a healthy and a cancer patient, or any patient. It can be any disease. So we are going to analyze like whose bacterial community has been increased or decreased, and then we are going to study that what kind of functions has been affected just because of this change in the microbial community, and then we are going to restore that functions either in the form of a diet or in bacteriophages or probiotics or prebiotics, or even sometimes we can use an antibiotics in order to stop the overgrowth of certain group of bacteria where this antibiotic should not affect our normal microbial flora, so that the person can be brought back from a cancer state or from disease state to a healthy state. So these are the various kinds of therapies which we are going to use in future in order to increase the diversity of microbes in a gut or to bring back an healthy disease individual to a healthy condition. So here we are having an fecal microbiota transplantation, prebiotics, probiotics, and a postbiotics. So what kind of treatments can be given in order to bring to a healthy state from a disease state? Like, we have in three different kinds of treatment options. The first generation is like, as we have been discussing, like fecal microbial transplanter. So it depends upon delivery mode, frequency, and donor. So delivery mode, we have two different kinds of modes. One is like through colonoscopy or through an enema. And it depends upon the donor, who is going to be from the same family. He should be from same family. And then the frequency, how often we should give. So like weekly once, or twice in a week, or 2 weeks once. So based upon this, the disease state will be retained back into a healthy state. And the next one is like a second generation method. So where we are going to selectively choose a certain kind of bacteria which can help us. So this is called as of a synthetic microbial community, or we can call it as of a synthetic cocktails. So we are going to choose, and we will be handpicking and selective bacteria which is going to help us, or which is going to bring back the healthy state. And the third generation will be like, we are going to identify further. We are going to identify what kind of functions this bacteria is going to perform, and we are going to isolate those specific genes thoroughly. And then we are going to find out what kind of compounds these are going to produce, and we are going to use those compounds as of treatment options. So these are the three different kinds of treatment options available for us in terms of a microbiome to bring an healthy individual, healthy state. So this is what about a human microbiome. And till now, what we know is like, we have been associated with 25 phyla, where we have 2000 genera and 5000 species, and 80% of metagenome has been mapped, and we are having almost 316 millions of genes has been associated with this 25 phyla. And what we know is a large amount of bacteria is still unknown. So you may ask, like, even with an culturable bacteria, we are left with 99%. Even in case of an uncultured method like this high throughput screening, still we are facing the problems, because like many bacterial functions has been not been identified. So research is going in this direction, like what are the functions which has been associated with each and every bacteria, and undefined or unidentified or uncultured bacteria. So we need to find out what are the functions of each and everything. So we have an undetected, still we don't know that few bacteria, and like 20% of sequences are not matching to the genome. So when we isolate the particular bacteria, and when we get and read, when we are tracing out the phylogeny of specific bacteria, we are unable to identify what kind of bacteria, because the genes is not matching with each other. And coming to the functions, still 40% of the genes functions is not matching with any functions. So still a lot is there to do and to identify. So we need to identify still many functions of each and every bacterial genes. So this is about our human microbiome and how we are going to perform a microbiome research. And I would like to take any questions if anyone is having. Thank you.
Madam.
Yes, sir. Ma'am, is there any questions in the chat box?
Hello.
Okay, this is the time for open discussion, ma'am. Shall we?
Hello.
Hello.
Yes, Samit sir. Marketing sir.
Ma'am.
Hello.
You can continue.
Hello.
Sir,
hello.
You can continue, sir.
Ma'am, can you hear my voice?
Yes, it is audible. You can continue.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for your wonderful talk. Now we have seen it was a indeed enlightening and so resourceful that it was quite amazing. Listen to you as well as very much pulling as two words. New trust area, definitely we enjoy as well as we well stuffed in knowledgeable way. Wholeheartedly thank for wonderful time, sir. Now this time for open discussion. Hello.
Yes, Magadeep sir.
Hello, ma'am.
Can you hear me? Any question in the chat box?
Hello.
Yes, message. There is no questions, ma'am.
No questions.
The chat box, ma'am. There is no questions. Dear participants, you can ask any doubts. You can clarify any doubts.
Hello.
Sir.
Yes.
Subramanian sir.
So.
Any questions are there?
Kalaiwani ma'am, do you have any questions? Do you have any doubt?
Nani?
Hello,
Nanindra, I have one doubt.
Yes, sir.
Due to aging, what has happened, the beneficial microorganism is in our body. During aging factor, so yeah. The microorganism which supports for us is going to reduce, isn't it?
Yeah.
It is possible to add the microorganism through diet or through some other source to prevent the aging factors.
Yeah, research is going in this direction actually. So they're trying to find out some products which is an microorganism origin. So in order to protect us from aging factors, so it can be done either by giving chemical products or directly the microorganisms can be given as of an probiotics or through FMT.
One more question. I have some infection. That times, what kind of microbes is more in our body, beneficial or non-beneficial microorganism?
Definitely, it will be an pathogens.
Oh, pathogens.
It will be if you are falling sick, it means it's a pathogen. If you are healthy, it means you are having a symbiont.
My question is, I am having disease. I have the pathogen. So that time the beneficial microorganism more and you fight with the pathogen and give the healthy status of me. That is my question.
Yeah, actually, as soon as you are going to get affected with certain kind of an bacteria, your immune system as well as your symbionts will try to defend it at first level. So sometimes, unfortunately, if our immune system and this microbial flora is suppressed by the pathogen, it means the pathogen is very strong. And it is going to, that as soon as the pathogen comes, there will be a little war between this pathogen as well as our immune system, as well as this healthy microbiome. And in this scenario, the pathogen is going to produce some strong kind of compounds, so which will be unfavorable for the beneficial bacteria. So pathogens will take an upper hand and it starts growing. As a result, we are going to get affected with a certain kind of disease.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
In chat box, Please, sir.
Hello.
So, sir, I have a question. For the metagenomics approach, is it possible to detect the virus and phage?
Yeah, sir. Yeah, there is a method we can easily detect and viruses and phages. But actually, why I didn't cover in this is I am not having experience in that. I am having experience only in terms of bacteria and fungi. So, but still we have and methods where it's quite good. Phages can be identified as well as viruses can be identified.
Okay, sir, I have another question too.
Yeah.
One of the slides you have mentioned the unborn bacteria, unborn child don't have any bacteria, any microbiomes. So is it it is not accessed or it is there's no any microbiome in unborn child?
Yeah, in case of unborn child, it means that unborn child means when the child is inside the womb of a mother. So inside womb of a mother, the baby is sterile. And
so your mic is off.
So when baby is inside the womb of a mother, he is sterile. And based on the mode of the birth, if the birth is through a normal mode, like vaginal birth, so while the baby is going to come out, he is going to carry the vaginal microbial flora around him so that he can sustain in this specific environment. And he starts having an breastfeed so that he will develop his resistance. Whereas the baby born through a C-section, he is not going to have this vaginal microbial flora around him. So at the initial stage itself, when he gets exposed to this environment, he is going to attain a different kind of a microbial community. And there is a study that because of this, the chances of getting asthma is more in case of a C-section birth. So that's a story for an unborn. So it means as we are developing inside the womb, we are sterile. When we come out of the womb, we are going to carry a microbial flora of our mother, and then which is going to give us a healthy state.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, one more question in the chat box. What is the post probiotic? Thought by Ilango and Ilango.
Host?
Post probiotic.
I think they are asking this one, right? Postbiotics.
Post probiotic.
Yeah, post probiotics are nothing but the compounds which has been produced by the bacteria. So in case of any one specific function, if you want to have a butyrate, if we know that the specific bacteria can produce a butyrate, so we are going to take only butyrates from that specific bacteria and then we are going to give it as of a treatment. That's called as of a postbiotics.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Hello.
And one more question, sir. If microbiome is unique for individuals, then how it is possible to treat common disorders with the common probiotics or any other common strategies?
See, microbiome is unique for each and every individual. So it means that individual is having specific kind of a function. Say, for an example, if I am going to eat bread, I am going to have a constipation. At the same time, my friend is going to eat the same bread. He is not going to have a constipation. It's because the microbial flora which he is maintaining is different, is helping him, whereas the microbial flora which I am having is not helping me. So this is the scenario which we are going to say it as of an unique. When we come for a common prebiotics, these are the biotics which can influence the already existing microbial flora of a specific individual. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Any other doubts?
Any other participants. Sir, one more question. Which microbes affect the immune system?
I am not sure about the specific bacteria which is going to affect the immune system. But as of now, we know that we have an Clostridium difficile, which is most pathogen, which is suppressing the immune system of an individual and leading to a colon cancer. It's an Clostridium difficile. They call it as often C. difficile.
Any other questions?
Sir, one more question. Using probiotic drink is good or bad?
Using probiotic is very good for health. It's not at all harmful.
Okay, sir.
Participants, any other questions?
The hand, but Saranamuti is there. Followed room top.
Sir, one more question.
Yeah, ma'am.
From Ariba, which type of microbes improve our colon health?
Lactobacillus, definitely. It's definitely Lactobacillus. That's the most prevalent bacterial community which is seen in gut of every human being.
Hello, sir. Good evening. This is a nice presentation, sir. So you're giving a lot of information from that from your presentation. Sir, I have a small doubt regarding recent and the fungal diseases, sir. So like black fungus, yellow fungus. So if you are a specialization in fungus, you already told. That's why I am asking that we didn't know that much of knowledge about that recent fungal disease. Can you explain, please, sir?
You are talking about fungal disease, right?
Yes.
Like black fungus.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Based on my knowledge, I'm sharing this. When we call it as often fungal disease, so we have and different kinds of fungus, which is going to give you and different kinds of colors. So if you take in black fungus, we have almost 6 varieties in that, which gives you black color. So usually we see the fungus in either white or in green. So this is the most common type of fungus which we have come across. So now this black fungus is an rhizobia, I think, which comes under mucormycota. So it's called as a mucormycota as a special class, which is having like around 30 organisms in this mucormycota. So this black fungus is very rare, actually. It's very rare, and where it can, it is wherever the humidity is more, it starts growing. And the impact, which I mean, not an impact actually. The establishment of fungus on human body gives you an idea that our immune system is very weak, because the naturally our immune system is very strong to different fungal infections. So we call it as like in candidiasis, or candida is the most common disease which will be seen in humans, and we have a strong immune system which can suppress this fungal communities. But this mucormycota is a newly appearing disease, and we have nearly like 5 to 6 fungus in that. So no one knows that which is exactly causing the disease. So they need to identify that, they need to isolate that, what kind of a community is overgrowth growing and all. So they commonly named it as often black fungus.
Thank you, sir. Sir, these fungus can able to change their genetic material in their own genetic material?
You mean like mutations?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fungus also having mutations, but it's not going to affect its morphology. So here we are going to call it like an gene knockouts. Genes will be lost. So it's like an evolutionary theory. If it is going to lose some gene, it is going to become in some other kind of a micro, some other fungal community.
Okay, sir. Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening, ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir, for your excellent presentation. Sir, I have one question. You told that sequencing is done in fecal samples nowadays.
Yes.
Is there any research is going on in sequencing of mucosa sample, like taking the sample from respiratory or vaginal?
Yeah, tracts, yeah, ma'am. Like... There are a lot of research is going on. So it's simple. You are going to take a mucus and you are going to find out a protocol to extract the DNA from that entire genomic DNA, and then you are going to use a specific primers and you are going to give it for a sequencing company. They will give you the sequences.
Okay, thank you,
sir. Every part of human body can be a sample collection place.
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thanks.
Thank you.
Sir, one more question in the chat box. How can maintain or increase of gut microbiome naturally in adult?
I am very sorry for this. I don't have an answer for this because it's something related to nutrition.
Okay,
I need to, maybe I need to refer to those things, like what foods can improve the microorganism community and all. But one thing for sure, I can say that we need a lot of lactobacillus in order to have a proper gut microbiome. So I suggest eating curd.
And one more question, sir. What microbes cause greenish color stool in adults?
That I'm very sorry. I don't know that.
Any other doubts from participants?
நிறைய போட்டு வச்சிடாம அப்புறம் தண்ணி ஊத்துனா எல்லாம் வெளியே போயிடும். ஒரே ஒரு ஓட்ட போதும். ஏன்னா இவ்வளவு ஹைட் உள்ளதுல நம்ம அவ்வளவு தண்ணி ஊத்த மாட்டோம்.
மேம்
சிக்கா மேம்
எஸ் மேம்
மேம் மேம் ஓகே மேம் any other clarification and any other doubts? Thank you sir.
Thank you, Armaish. I take this opportunity again to thank organizing secretaries for giving me this opportunity to share my research. Thank you again.
Thank you sir.
Again, one more doubt. Oncogenic effect? What is oncogenic chat box?
Oncogenic effect means cancer causing. So what are the bacteria? If certain bacterial population is decreasing, say, as I said, C. difficile, it is going to increase the chances of cancer, colon cancer.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Ma'am, any more questions? Okay, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much for your
thank you
nice presentation, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Finally, to thank everyone who are responsible to conduct of the seminar as well as the patient participants, I would like to call Dr. J. Sifa Vanmadi, ma'am, assistant professor, to deliver the heartfelt thanks through vote of thanks.
Yes, it gives me an immense pleasure to deliver the vote of thanks for this event to all. First of all, I extend my most sincere thanks to Almighty God for making today's event a resounding success. Next, I would like to express our profound thanks to our principal, Dr. A. Muhammad Sadiq, and vice principal, SMSAN Muhammad Gajar sir, who spare time from their schedule to grace the occasion and surely will be going to encourage us in our future events. Next, I also wish to express my gratitude to our resource person, Dr. T. Dhanendra Shanmugam. We are the participants are really enlightened with your knowledge, sir. Next, I would like to thank our convener, Dr. M.A. Zagir Hussain, sir, and Dr. M.A. Dilita Manoj Joyce, Organizing Secretary and HOD of PG Department of Zoology, for their huge efforts, support, organizing, guidance, and making the event success today. I'm happy to express my thanks to all the participants who actively participated. Once again, I thank all for your cordial cooperation. Thank you once again. The feedback link is given here. You can send your feedback, participants. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Ma'am, once again, send that feedback link to the chat box, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. The feedback link is given in the chat box.
Okay, ma'am. Okay.
Yes.
Zakir sir?
Madam, please stop the recording. It's finished.
Shifa, ma'am? Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, can stop the recording, ma'am.
அதையும் கொஞ்சம் ஸ்டாப் பண்ணுங்க.
ஓகே ஓகே.